name is Alyssa.
And I'm Emily.
And you're listening to Slash and Slay, a horror podcast.
Should we start our
episode? Oh my gosh, we're starting our first episode back, season two.
Everybody,
very excited. Obviously we are on camera.
Yes,
so hello to all the cameras.
Do we look like how you thought we looked?
Yeah,
even though you've definitely seen this before on Instagram, but if you haven't,
and our like profile picture for
right for everything, yeah,
so you've our faces, so
definitely seen us.
You should know what we look like.
You should know what we look like. But now we're in like pink and blue and cutesy.
We have a new brand, if you will.
We're gonna have a new logo. We have some new colors, new vibe. We're kind of trying to get a little more focused here.
Yeah,
and we are really trying to appeal to a lot of you that have actually reached out and have been like, I really enjoy your podcast because you guys talk about horror movies and I get really scared and I don't really want to watch horror movies, but y'all talk about the plot and everything.
And so that they can kind of watch the horror movies through us. So we're kind of leaning into that a little bit.
Yeah, I think. And honestly, it's like for the girlies, you know, like the girlies are the ones that don't really want to watch horror movies. Mm-hmm. I've been there before where there's some horror movies I really don't want to watch and I'll just
smile.
Smile. I'll just look up what happens. Yeah. I'll watch a recap, the kill count.
So now
so we're going to do that for you guys.
Now people can watch us instead.
Yeah. And I honestly think this episode's going to be perfect because we're going to talk about like our top horror movies for the girlies.
Yes, we're gonna get into some movies that we think are just, they're very female centric, they're very like powerful, I would say, and but we're also gonna talk about whether we actually like them or not.
Yes.
So
we'll see. Oh, but like first, the biggest news of all, Alyssa, what's on that finger?
Oh, I don't know. For those of you listening and
guys,
can't see,
she said yes to me.
I said yes to Emily. She asked.
Finally.
No, I got engaged.
Yes!
And
the ring is beautiful. Can we get a close up of the ring?
The close up of that ring.
It's beautiful.
It's an opal. I didn't want a traditional diamond because I'm not really a diamond girly. So,
I'm an opal gal.
So
beautiful and exciting.
It's exciting.
So
news.
Happy. Yes, that's like the biggest thing.
It's probably the biggest thing that's happened since our end of season one
hiatus. Yes. Mm-hmm. Have you missed us, guys?
Yeah. Let us know in the comments.
Please tell us how much you've missed us. I think we should do like a little recap of what we've been watching though too.
Yes.
Because so, I've been on a kick with my Kindle really. Like I rediscovered that I love my Kindle and I've been, every time I'm on the treadmill, I just plop it up there and I just.
Well, it's definitely good for, you know, being able to do multiple books at a time. I just have a hard, like I have started reading on my phone just because it's more accessible, but I just miss like holding a book and smelling a book.
I thought I do but I don't. Like especially if I'm just reading in bed, I'm like, oh my gosh, like I cannot hold this thing like this, like it's just so annoying, which sounds like such a
first world problem.
Yeah. And also literally I want so bad, it's like somebody buy this for me please. It's like $30 on Amazon and it's like this clip that you put on your Kindle and when you're like walking on the treadmill, or most people I've seen them like get a gooseneck thing and they just lay down and then you put this clicker and you just like, you just click it and it just like
that
turns
the laziest thing I've ever heard.
But I just want it for the treadmill so I feel a little better because it's just like me clicking and like walking because I literally have the font so big that it's like two sentences and I'm like swipe. Swipe. So it's just so annoying.
Okay. Well,
so someone buy that for
someone
me,
someone get that for Emily and send it to our PO box that we do not have.
Yeah. But anyway, I haven't been just reading on my Kindle, but I pretty much have. But I have read Fantasticland.
That was a wreck by me.
Yes, finally. I finally read it. I was so nervous because I was like, I don't think I'm gonna like this because it was a lot of words. Honestly, I just looked at the format, I was like, this is a lot of words.
And it's very different. It's a very different style. It's a very different kind of format. So
yeah, because it's like a journalist, it's like interview style, mm-hmm. which is something I've never really read before, but it almost read like a nonfiction, yeah. which was so cool. Because I do not, I'm sorry, I don't, I read for entertainment. I do not read to learn. Sorry.
Same. I don't want to read exciting things about people's like real lives.
No,
like,
I don't care.
I want it to be fake. Give yes. me fake all day.
Yeah. So I read Fantastic Man finally. Mm-hmm. Super good.
Yeah.
Really, really good. I'll give you a sleigh, like
a free sleigh.
I also read a really cheesy romance called Love in the Time of Serial Killers mm-hmm. by Alicia Thompson.
Mm-hmm.
It was really cheesy. Very.
But good? Was it good?
I mean, it's fine.
It's like, was it a sleigh?
I would say the cover's really cute.
Maybe it's the ampersand.
Yeah, maybe
that's
it's
that. Like the middle.
Yeah, yeah. I also read In My Dreams I Hold a Knife, which is a little thriller. It was fun. Dark Academia
mm-hmm.
for a book club I'm in. And then like movies and TV shows. I watched Scream 6.
Yes.
I'm not going to say anything about it.
We'll talk about that some other time. Maybe.
If I can convince you to watch it
before the end of the year.
Yeah. And then I finished The Last of Us this last week. I
haven't started it yet.
Well, it's over now, so.
Well, I know. I know about I watched the video game playthrough, so I know it's not the exact same, but I pretty much know it. Well, I haven't been doing quite as much as you. I am currently listening to an audiobook called The Hatching by Ezekiel Boone.
I think I've heard of that.
It's basically like a pandemic novel, but
just like us guys,
but spiders.
Oh,
it's like man-eating spiders.
Oh, hatching, like
spiders hatching.
Ew.
And it's kind of gross. There's a lot of characters and I really haven't attached to any of them, so that's a little difficult, but I mean it's not bad.
But do you think it's because of it's like an audiobook, so you're not like really like
maybe. That could be part of it.
That happens to me.
I'm going to be starting a book called The Lost Village by Camilla Sten. That's a book I have, like a real life book.
A real life book? That I get to hold
in my hands, but I'm going to start that afterwards. And actually last night, I watched Jeepers Creepers Reborn. And it was the worst thing I've ever seen in my entire life. And
wait, when did that come out? Last year?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh.
On Hulu, I believe.
It just went straight to Hulu?
Yeah, no, it didn't go to theater. It was like a Hulu like original
movie. Oh my gosh, no.
No, it was so bad. And they've tried to do several sequels from 1 and 2. They did a third one and it was terrible. I think they did that one on Netflix. And then
is it like all canon or
kind of? I don't know. The makeup, the like special effects makeup was so bad. It was like why, like it was so good back in the early 2000s when they made it. And now it's like, they just try too hard. And they like try to add like, I think some CGI to it too, which does not look realistic at all. So it was horrible. I couldn't even really tell you what happened because I kind of like zoned out and got on my phone and played my Wordscapes. So
I got back on Wordscapes too.
Did you? What level are you on?
I'm not anywhere near you, but I got on this game called, I can't even say what it's called. It's like SP exclamation point. NG
mm-hmm.
and it's on Apple Arcade and it made me the angriest I've ever been in my life.
Really?
Like I literally had to delete it because I was just in my room being like raging on my phone.
I hate rage games. I can't.
I had to delete it, but I'm back on my Wordscapes. It's chill. Just swipe it
that's
around.
That's what happened to me with SpongeBob Diner Dash. It made me so mad. It made me so mad. These people kept yelling at me about their freaking pancakes. I had to delete it too. So,
Well, stay away from that. For realizing our anger and not rage gaming, yes. And just deleting it.
Yeah.
But so can you give us a free slash then on Jeepers Creepers Reborn?
Yeah, slash okay. Slash it all the way back to hell.
In case you didn't
know,
she slashes that one.
I slash it.
Should we get into some maybe slays?
Some maybe slays.
Maybe slays. Our movies that we're going to talk about. We might slay them. Yeah. We might slash them.
Yeah.
Who knows?
Let's get into our movies for the girlies.
Yes. I just realized we were supposed to talk about them in like order of least gory to most gory.
Right.
But we can just be like, this one's a...
Yeah.
A scale. We'll give it a scale of gore. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, a one can be a stab, maybe. And then a 10 can be you see intestines.
Okay.
Is that good?
Yeah.
I don't know. What one, a stab's kind of gory already.
A stab could be gory. Okay. But it's a horror movie. You have to expect there's going to be something like that.
There's going to be something.
I say stab to guts. Stab to guts. Stab to,
you see guts coming out. Yeah. Okay. Well, Jennifer's body is number one that we started that we're going to start talking mm-hmm. about. And that one you do see guts in this one, okay? So this is not for the faint of heart.
Mm-mm.
Here's a quick little synopsis of Jennifer's body.
Go for it.
I was laughing reading this earlier. She's evil, and not just high school evil. Who wrote this?
Well, that was one of the lines. I watched it today. Oh, it was okay, one okay. of the lines in the movie.
I haven't
movie.
Seen it in over a year. So.
Yeah, it was a long time since I saw it. So I was like, I want to see. So it was a line
okay.
that Amanda Seyfried's okay, character funny. Says.
Okay, so. She's evil, and not just high school evil. When a demon takes possession of high school hottie Jennifer, Megan Fox, she turns a hungry eye on guys who never stood a chance with her before. While evil Jennifer satisfies her appetite for human flesh with the school's male population, her nerdy friend, needy Amanda Seyfried, learns what's happening and vows to put an end to the carnage. This came out in 2009, mm-hmm. directed by Karen Kusama. Written by Diablo Cody, who was known for writing Juno, and he was also one of the writers on Evil Dead. Oh, so sorry. She, Diablo Cody. I'm so sorry. It's girl power here. Known for writing Juno and one of the writers on Evil Dead 2013. 2009. That's when my brother was born.
That's when I graduated high school.
Oh my God.
Wow.
Crazy. So did you see this like in high school?
Mm-mm.
Oh, okay.
I probably did not interest me at all, to be honest, because I think the trailers were very, very just sexual, if I remember correctly. And I mean, the whole movie is somewhat, I mean, it is. It's very sexual.
It's very like sexual awakening, little
yes.
gay icon vibes.
Mm-hmm. Some of it is a little unnecessary, just like, there was a part where she's getting out of the lake naked, and there was really no reason why she was needed to be in the lake. It was just really random.
I don't
random.
Remember this part.
It was just random.
Maybe they're like, we got Megan Fox, dude.
I guess they're like, we're going to use her in every way.
Megan Fox probably, if I look like Megan Fox, I'd be like, yes, I will be naked in the lake.
She is really.
Yeah, she's gorgeous.
So pretty.
I just like the vibes of this movie. I watched mm-hmm. this for the first time like a year and a half ago, and I was like, oh my gosh, the low rise. Like, what yes. are you doing?
It's
like,
very, it wow. is very early 2000s.
Like, those aren't flattering on anybody.
Mm-mm. Mm-mm.
But still Megan Fox looks great. Pulls it off. She looks great.
She pulls it off.
Yeah. I just kept thinking like, wow, this really is like, My Best Friend's Exorcism is just a
ripoff.
That's
what I was thinking.
Yeah.
I was like, this is what my best friend's Exorcism wanted to be.
This is what it really wanted to be. Yes. Like, I feel like, My Best Friend's Exorcism wanted to be this like
edgy
and gory and mm-hmm. like just like really lean into like the gay and like queerness of it and like completely satanic, and they were just like, we're just gonna dip our toes in it,
right,
and be like, maybe,
right,
but this no, one
this,
really
this went all out
this yes. really did. And like, it gave me so much nostalgia, because when I watched like teen movies as a kid, and I was like, that's what a 16-year-old looks like.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you know, yeah. Like, that's 100% what she looks like. And then when I got to be 16, I was like, oh, like, that's, I don't look like Megan Fox.
Right.
But it was, like, so fun to, like, watch it and be like, oh, my gosh. I remember, like, watching Mean Girls and being like, oh, my gosh, that's, you know, what I feel like being in high school is like, when it's really not at all.
Yeah.
But I do really like she's the iconic, good for her.
Oh, yeah.
The good for her moment.
Yes.
And just her story of revenge, you really are like, yeah, like, go mm-hmm. for it. You know, like, yeah, you're being a little crazy.
Yeah.
But like, okay.
Yeah.
So are these men. Like, they're being horrible.
Yeah. I really like the female friendship dynamic, you know, of the, like, kind of the mean friend.
Mm-hmm. And it's so cliche, but it works.
It's so cliche, but it really works in this scenario. With
Yeah. Yeah. It's like their friendship is just like it. Even watching it like a year and a half ago, I was still like, yeah, like, of course they're going to be like that. Of course, they're going to be the nerdy friend, the like hot friend.
Kind of like the toxic, I mean, the toxic friendships that you have.
Yeah. And how you will stand by your high school best friend no matter what, no matter what they're doing. You're like, of course I'm going to, you know, besties, whatever. And I think it's just, yeah. The reason why I would say this one, apart from all the reasons I've already said, is specifically for the girlies, like, boys, you're not allowed to watch this. I'm kidding.
No boys allowed.
It just really is, like I was saying, the revenge arc is, it's everything you want in a good for her movie, in horror.
And kind of like the empowerment of like, oh, you're going to look at my body this way and want to use me this way, and I'm gonna use you.
Yeah, I'm gonna use that to my advantage. And I also think it's interesting to see how like Megan Fox character, how Jennifer Jennifer was like so obsessed with her body and everything.
And the way so she looked. Yeah,
with that and using it. And then once she becomes possessed by this entity, that's when she's like, she completely becomes obsessed with something else, but still uses what she has to get what she wants in that way. So she uses it instead of getting attention. She uses it to get revenge.
The whole thing is that she is feeding on these men to make her stronger and to make her more beautiful. Because when she doesn't feed on them, she'll like, her hair is dull, she has acne. And then after she feeds on them, she's strong, her hair is like beautiful, and she looks perfect, and
yeah,
all that.
In my opinion, this one's a bit of a slash because it is very, it has some gory moments, like specifically that one in the abandoned house.
Yes,
that one was rough.
Yeah, it was gross.
That was gross. Do you think this one's a slash or a slay?
I think it's also a slash.
Slash.
And I would give it like
There's guts,
but I would give it like a 7.
Okay.
On the gory scale, personally, for me.
For me, I would have to give it an 8.5. We're doing halves. We're doing halves.
We can do halves.
It's a little much for me, but still really good. And I do like the, I think we haven't even talked about Needy. Like,
oh, yeah.
She's also like a very strong woman that doesn't seem like it.
Yeah. But. And because she's very underestimated the whole time. Everyone looks at her as just like the friend. She's like the friend that just will go along with whatever. But in the end, she doesn't.
And she's also just doing like going along with what men want her to do, too. Mm-hmm. Just like how Jennifer was at the beginning.
Yeah.
And then by the end of it, she's like, you know, no. And it's so sad for her.
I know.
Like, you feel so bad.
But she's, I mean, she ultimately comes around to also get revenge, because at the very end, when she escapes the mental hospital, and she's going after the bandmates that did that to Jennifer.
Yeah.
So
thank God.
Yeah. We love revenge.
We love revenge. We encourage it. Please enact your revenge on anybody, especially men, right?
Right.
What other movies we got?
So the next movie we have that we're talking about is It Follows.
What follows?
It Follows. Here is a little synopsis.
I used to daydream about being old enough.
After carefree teenager Jay sleeps with her new boyfriend Hugh for the first time, she learns that she is the latest recipient of a fatal curse that is passed from victim to victim via sexual intercourse. Death, Jay learns, will creep inexorably toward her as either a friend or a stranger. Jay's friends don't believe her seemingly paranoid ravings until they too begin to see the phantom assassins and band together to help her flee or defend herself. This came out in 2014. It was written and directed by David Robert Mitchell, who also directed Under the Silver Lake, but he hasn't really done much else. Like that.
Interesting.
What are your thoughts on It Follows?
Now, I will say, before I say anything about this movie, mm-hmm. I watched this 2-3 years ago now, mm-hmm. and I just wasn't really into horror then. So I didn't really like this movie whenever I first watched it. And I think, I don't know, going into it, I was expecting it to be something else. And I don't know, maybe it was just disappointing. I definitely want to revisit it because so many people love it. And I've always just kind of been like, it was all right.
Yeah. It's a very interesting concept.
Oh, yeah.
And I like kind of say it's a very quiet horror movie mm-hmm. because of the villain, who is basically just like this, I mean, this entity, this creature, this ghost we don't really know.
Logistics, it's quiet.
Yeah. It's literally
quiet and it walks.
It literally just walks after. That's how they can put it off for a certain amount of time, but it's eventually always going to catch up with you. This whole movie, it really is just one giant metaphor.
Yes, honestly. I agree. Well, not like I agree. It's like fact. Yeah. I agree
that it's a fact.
Yeah. I actually saw something and I should have written this down, but I think the director, he also wrote it. He wrote this like based off of his nightmares as a kid mm-hmm. where somebody was always following him. Uh-huh. And that freaked me out. I was like, ugh. Like,
it well, is, why are you it having is just this nightmares? Very like, it's just unsettling.
Because it's like, you can run so fast, but it's like.
Right. It will eventually always it will. Find you. No matter how far you can go, super far, it's slow. So you could wait it out a couple weeks, but eventually it's going to.
Yeah, you can't like just run from it.
You can't, and you can't just stay in one place either.
No. And of course, if you don't know, it is a metaphor for like a sexually transmitted disease. Mm-hmm. And I think it's also just like another huge spotlight on like the anxiety that comes from being a teenage girl and mm-hmm. desiring intimacy and getting that intimacy and then being the consequences burned. Yeah.
or whatever mm-hmm. of that. Yeah.
And also not knowing, like, mm-hmm. especially in certain cultures and things like that, like you aren't taught or anything like that. So you're just kind of on your own. Mm-hmm. And then if you were in this position, this right. horrible thing happens to you. And after you're vulnerable and mm-hmm. intimate
and
with
there's
someone.
Literally like a moment where like, right after they did it mm-hmm. she's like telling him this intimate thing, or she's telling him these thoughts that she's had, and he's like kind of creeping behind her but being like sweet. You think, oh, they're gonna get it on again, and then he like chloroforms her.
Yeah.
And just like the like you were saying, the being in those intimate moments and having it just like ripped out from under you.
Yeah. And so after, of course, this intimate moment, she realizes, she's explained that this entity is attached to her,
and that this
her.
Guy, I mean, he did it on purpose. Yeah. Obviously, he did it knowing. And there's like that whole thing, like, you should. It's like an urban legend, but I think it's also real too, where it's like this girl goes on vacation, meets this guy. They have like all this wonderful time together. He gives her a card to read on the plane. He says, don't read until you're on the plane. And then she gets on the plane and it says, psych, I just gave you a STD.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like that.
Yeah.
Whole urban legend. Ow.
Yeah. Ouch.
kind of like that urban legend that isn't so urban or legend, because I think people do that.
Yeah. And it just like also shows how it just complicated her relationships with her family, with mm-hmm. her friends, with her future love interests, her future partners, and how it basically turned her life upside down from this one thing that happened this one night.
Yeah.
And I don't know, it's very relatable for a young woman, especially someone who has trouble letting their guard down mm-hmm. and, you know, being vulnerable with others, even, you know, in friendships and things like that, because it's just like, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
You could get burned. You could get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
And
it's also very ambiguous in the movie, like what actually happens in the end.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it makes it seem like the one of the guys that she passed it on to, like purposefully, like they agreed together, he passed it on to like a prostitute.
Mm.
I think's what happened. who would then, you know,
mm-hmm. who knows,
pass it on to whoever who, because it's like, if you don't know, it's if you, so you pass it on and then, but if that person who passed it on to dies, it goes back to you. Yes. So it could go back all the way down the chain. So that's like, there's also kind of an ethical question of like, what would you do? Would you just like go sleep with someone to get rid of it and hope that they survive? Like do what Hugh, the guy did? I mean, or do you just run from it? Like, what do you do? What would you do?
I like at that point,
just,
I mean, what would happen if you, okay, if you killed yourself, it would go back. It would still go back, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think I just have to let it kill me, because I'd be like, okay, right. Like, sorry. Right. I'm not going to give it to someone else. Like, eventually it'll reach the end of the chain.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
True. I mean, or it's just going to, I mean, it's just going to go to someone else. Right. So either way, it's, I don't know. I mean,
it's,
I don't.
It's horrible. It's, I like, wouldn't.
I just don't think I could.
No.
So just let it take me.
Yeah.
All it does is your, like, it touches now. You and, like, sucks.
But then I'd be like, if it kills me, I'd be like, yeah, because this person, now this person has to deal with it again because they gave it to me.
Yeah. Like, so take that. Yeah. Revenge. This is about revenge.
This is my revenge story. Like, oh, but also the fight at the end is pretty good too.
In the pool?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. And it comes to her as her dad, I mm-hmm. believe. It's like just throwing TVs at her.
Yeah. It's giving me so much anxiety. I was like, oh.
I know.
I hate pool scenes, but it was still fun.
Yeah. Fun, it was, I mean, overall, it's a good movie. I think it's a good girly movie, I think.
Yeah, I think it's good, especially, like, I don't know. What would you watch? Who would you watch this with?
Your friends.
Your friends.
Don't watch it on a date.
I think I watched it with my boyfriend.
Oh. Well, he's your friend.
Yeah.
Your boyfriend, he's so it's friend. That's fine.
Yeah, my friend.
So do you slash it or do you say it?
I slash it. Yeah, I slashed it.
Isolated.
It's a very dark, like, I don't know.
It's very,
like,
dark.
Yeah, it's kind of dark, like, film.
The whole thing vibe. Is, like, the coloring.
Everything is very dark. Yeah, so it's not really, like, a...
But I slay it. I slay.
Okay.
On the scale of...
Knife to guts?
Yes, whatever we said.
I would say it's a TV in a pool, so that's, like, a... Did they get electrocuted? No. There's a gun at the end.
There's a gun. I would give it like a 3.
Okay.
It really is not.
I don't remember, so.
It's not gory at all.
I'll agree with your 3 because I don't remember.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. We recommend that one.
All right.
Okay, next we're going to talk about the iconic, like, the first, not the first, one of the first.
Mm-hmm.
Really good high school girly horror movies, and that is Carrie.
It's the night of the senior prom.
Carrie White is a shy and troubled teenage girl who is tormented by her high school peers, and her fanatically religious mother begins to use her powers of telekinesis to exact revenge upon them. And this, the one we're talking about, is the 1976 version, directed by Brian De Palma, known for directing Al Pacino, Scarface, Blowout, and the first Mission Impossible. It was written by Lawrence D. Cohen, who was one of the writers on the 2013 remake of Carrie, and also wrote the book for Carrie the Musical. Have you ever heard any of the musicals?
I haven't.
I directed a scene in college with one of the songs. Gun in my head, couldn't tell you one word of that song, but it had one good song, and it was that one. So sorry.
And obviously, Lawrence, we all know the story is by Stephen King.
Yeah, who did the synopsis and didn't put Stephen King?
I don't know.
A hater.
Who,
a hater.
Who would do that?
Carrie.
This is. I remember seeing this movie on TV. And it kind of scaring me when I was like,
it's kind of scary.
A child. It just, the mom really scared me.
Mom is scary.
The mom is really scary. And there's like a part, I think, towards the end where Carrie like throws knives or something. And that part scared me.
It is a very like high, it's a very tense at the end. Like the whole movie is not very tense. And then there is that one part in the end in the attic.
Yeah. I mean, once she loses it. Yeah. I mean,
she loses it.
Which we love.
Yeah.
We love when the girlies lose it, honestly.
Honestly. I just think this is the perfect, and thank you, Mr. King, for this being, this is his first published novel. Mm-hmm. And for an old man, he really got the coming of age of a teenage girl down pretty well. Like even talking about right off the bat, like coming into puberty and your hormones changing and having to deal with your peers. And, you know, I never went to public high school, but even dealing with like my own peers was traumatizing. So I can imagine like dealing with it in that kind of setting. And I really enjoy the complicated mother-daughter dynamic. I think that is something every teenage girl can relate to because everybody like hates their mom, you know, in high school. Not like hates, but you know, like, oh my God.
Everyone has something.
My mom was not like to this
level.
No.
But some people to this
some
level.
Some people do have abusive parents, like emotionally abusive parents and even physically abusive, which is horrendous. And I think
her mom is definitely that.
Yes, that extreme for sure.
She locks her in a closet all the time.
For the sake of religion. And I think that having something as your first novel, like something that subtle and profound and horrific, like I think that really sets the tone for what I think a lot of people miss in Stephen King. I'm going on my Stephen King rant now, where people are always like, oh my gosh, he can't write women, blah, blah, blah. Okay, listen. I think the way that his characters treat women is part of the horror,
right?
Okay?
I agree. So. I do. And sometimes, yes, he has some lines that are like questionable. We don't have to talk about that.
We don't have to talk about how he talks about nipples, okay?
We don't have time to go into that. But I mean, ultimately, I mean, the thing with him is like, I know he like how much he loves his wife, and his wife was always a reader for him. Like I guess they didn't call it that back then, but a sensitivity reader in a way. For him. So I think he gets it. I think he gets it right in a lot of ways.
We're giving Stephen King a pass on this one.
Yes.
Nothing. No, I think we're this not one is very, it. Very tasteful compared to other things he said. Yeah, we're not talking about it. Mm-mm. I think he really like hits the nail on the head with this one and like the subtle, like how horrific it is to be a teenage girl.
Yeah. And then just like
without telekinesis.
Like, right. And like, just like turning it up and like, the bullying. I mean, I personally did not experience severe bullying.
I did bullying, not experience severe bullying.
But I know people who have. Mm-hmm. And even in this day and age, and this was like back in the 70s, and her being ostracized for being weird and not knowing anything about like having a period and getting tampons thrown at her. Like,
horrible.
It's awful.
Yeah.
But then, of course, we have the iconic a pig blood on her head scene.
And she says, okay, we're going to play it that way.
She says, all right, it's time. Yeah. It's time to get revenge. And you, as we've said, we love revenge here.
It is like the ultimate revenge on everything.
And everybody.
And everybody. Including her mother, you know, which I'm not gonna say, I'm not the person to say she deserved it or not, but like I'm not mad at Carrie. I'm not mad at Carrie.
I'm not personally I don't have anything against Carrie.
Yeah.
But it's just a girly pop movie.
Yeah.
If you ask
I think
me.
So too. I think like and I think this one's very mild too. The blood is pig blood. It's not that's the most
I would say.
Maybe we should have made number one bucket of pig blood.
Oh yeah.
Because like, it's not bad. Is a stab.
There is like that knife scene, but again, it's like it's this was like the 1970s, so it's not super.
No,
realistic.
They do make the mom look really scary, though.
Yeah, but gore wise, I would give it like a one or maybe two. Maybe we could say two if you don't like
two,
looking
at
any kind of blood.
Blood.
Yeah,
yeah. I think this one would be a perfect slumber party movie too.
Oh yeah.
Like on the background.
Mm-hmm. Y'all could just like throw tampons on each other.
Yeah, be like,
instead
yeah,
of
catch.
A pillow fight.
Yeah, that'd
it's
be so
a
fun.
Great idea.
Yeah, that'd be hilarious.
Love it.
That's a good bachelorette party
idea.
Should
we
do
go.
That?
Yeah, let's just recreate Carrie.
Oh my gosh.
For my bachelorette party.
Okay.
Throw I'll blood
you.
On my head.
Like I've always wanted.
Throw blood on my head. Give me the the prom queen and then throw blood on me.
Yeah.
I'll set you all on fire. It'll be great.
Okay. Electrocute you.
It'll be fun.
Lock the doors.
Mm-hmm. Love it.
Very cool.
Oh, wait. We forgot to slash and slay it.
Oh.
I slay.
I slay.
Next, we have Aliens. That's the sequel to Alien.
Mm-hmm.
In case you mm-hmm. didn't know that.
Just tell me one thing, Burke. You're going out there to destroy them, right?
When Ripley's life pod is found by a salvage crew over 50 years later, she finds that terraformers are on the very planet they found the alien species. When the company sends a family of colonists out to investigate her story, all contact is lost with the planet and colonists. They enlist Ripley and the Colonial Marines to return and search for answers. This came out in 1986. It was directed by James Cameron, famous for Avatar 1 and 2, Titanic, and Terminator. And it was also written by James Cameron and two other people that we will not mention.
Two others. So James Cameron did some, like... James Cameron did some other little flicks. Yeah, some little B-movies.
He sure did.
And Aliens.
Aliens. And I love this movie.
I love this movie too. Obviously, you know, my cat's named after Ripley.
Mm-hmm.
We love Ripley here mm-hmm. on the pod. We close love personal Ripley. Friend Ripley.
Mm-hmm.
She is just consistently like just a badass.
She is.
She's a badass. Like, I love space movies. And it's just like, you don't see that kind of like women representation yeah. in space movies. Not yes. to be like that, but like,
it's usually
really don't.
Like girls with their boobies out and be like, being like, well, what do I do?
I'm actually an alien.
Do I push this button? Yeah, exactly. And so,
and she's literally just like, she's such a mama bear. The whole, yes. from even the first one, she's like, let me fix, like, I got mm-hmm. this, you know? Mm-hmm. And I can't remember. In the first one, is she like in charge from the beginning? Or is like, I think everybody in charge of her dies and then she's kind
there,
of in charge.
Yeah, there is, because there's that, the guy who's above her, but he, isn't he, turns out to be an alien? Not alien, a robot.
The milky guys.
Yeah, the milky.
That milky.
That milk. The their milky blood guys. Is milk.
What are they called?
Androids.
I knew. I almost heard said Avatar. That.
They're called God? Avatars. God? Androids?
I almost said Avatars. The other thing about this one is another very important woman in this movie is the alien.
Yes.
The mama.
She the mama.
She's the mama alien. And all she's trying to do is protect her little babies.
Yes.
And these colonizers are coming. And she's like, get away from my mm-hmm. babies.
And then we have Ripley trying to protect Newt, which we love.
Little baby Newt.
Love Newt.
We have a wide array of representation.
Although
we
she
have...
kind of bothers me because she keeps running off.
She's really dirty too.
She's very dirty. Like, take a bath.
Yes,
like,
please.
Give her, just give
you
her.
Smell.
Just take a second to give her a bath. Like, it's fine.
Yeah, not a very good mama bear, Ripley.
Yeah.
Can
but you that's okay. Baby? She also, like, has to tote that machine gun, so...
Yeah, was I was looking at pictures and she's like holding the yeah. baby and just like, grr. I'm like, oh, okay, no one asked you to do that. But yeah, I just think like this one is such a fun, like this one really would be a fun summer party movie because it's yes. like very surface level. Uh-huh. It's just like Ripley beating up aliens.
We're
and
fighting
we have
aliens.
A little baby now mm-hmm. and she's in charge and the alien still wants to protect her babies.
Yeah, and they're after, they have the same goal.
Yeah,
ultimately
they all just want to like not die and protect their young, and yeah, I think it's so fun. It's
me
such
too
a fun one.
It's such a fun one. Aliens, this the franchise overall I love personally.
I will say the first Alien movie I saw was with you at your apartment and I watched Alien Covenant.
No.
Yes.
That's false.
Why?
We watched Alien, the original Alien.
I don't think so.
Yes, we did. At my small apartment. Yes. See?
Okay. Sorry, God.
God knows.
Okay. Well, wait. Your small apartment, did you live there before or after?
Before.
Okay. So I guess I did watch Alien.
Mm-hmm.
And then I watched Alien Covenant.
Yeah,
just
we watched
that,
that
one. But I remember we got like Chinese food and I was like watching it and I was literally like,
vomiting.
That one shower scene, Do you know what I'm talking about?
I think so.
Oh my gosh, I wanted to throw up. It was so disgusting.
When the baby is coming out?
I don't remember. I just remember like they're having sex in the shower and then just like this comes and yeah.
I get them all confused. I just I remember, love them like, all, but I get them Chinese all confused. Food
and like wanting to throw up so bad because I was like, this is horrible.
That's before so you bad. Can stomach anything.
Yeah, now I'm like eating Chinese food every day and watching horror movies for breakfast, lunch, every and dinner.
Single day. Just watch all the guts.
So, Aliens. What do we rate it? There's guns. I haven't watched in a while.
I don't really think there's not that much like
a lot of tension. It's literally
Ripley and Newt, and no aliens come out of the Tum Tum. I don't think.
I really don't think so either.
So,
okay, maybe
it's like, I would give it like a
go to the Tum Tum. No aliens come out the Tum Tum.
No aliens come out the Tum Tum. Tum Tum. I would give it like a 3.
Okay, I'll agree with that because I haven't seen it in a while. You are the gore master.
I am, and I also slay it.
I slay it too. Slay.
Slay.
What's our next one? Let's see. Ooh, a good one. A good modern one.
Mm-hmm.
Ready or Not.
Here I come.
No. Wait, is that... That's Bridget Mendler, Ready or Not, from Disney Channel, from Good Luck Charlie, and the baby. Anyway,
no, that's what
she's not in this. She's not in this one. Like, can you imagine if it was her? I wouldn't have watched it. I've been like, okay, girl, go off, I guess, but I'm not watching it.
I do not believe that you are.
I don't believe it.
When are you going to start singing? Where's Charlie?
Where's Charlie in Ready or Not?
Right. Bring her out.
Good luck, Charlie, at the end of Ready or Not. Next time you try to get married and you want to play a game the wedding night, good luck, Charlie. Good luck,
Charlie. And it like just turns off.
Yeah, the game quarter.
Yes.
Gabe, you orchestrated this whole game? Anyway, are we going to keep doing this bit? Okay.
No.
So this one is actually, we're going to be taking notes for this one because we have a wedding coming up.
Right? Yes.
So, at midnight, you have to play a game.
Why?
It's just something we do when someone...
A bride's wedding night takes a sinister turn when her eccentric new in-laws force her to take part in a terrifying game.
Wow.
Ooh. This was in 2019. Directed by Radio Silence, Tyler Gillett? We don't know. Tyler. And Matt... Oh my gosh.
Bettinelli Alpin.
Bettinelli Alpine. I don't know. Sorry, everybody. We need the
Google Translate.
Written by Guy Busick and R. Christopher Murphy. Busick also wrote Scream 5 and 6, which we love. Actually, I said I wouldn't say
your opinion.
We love that he wrote it. Good for him. Getting more jobs. Yes. That's what I mean.
That's what we love about it.
I support people getting jobs.
Me too.
2019, not that long ago.
Yeah.
I just love the vibe of this movie above everything else. It has like that old money. Mm-hmm. It's kind of like a Clue board.
Yeah, it is very, it's a little very Knives Clue. Out,
literally. Mm-hmm.
But a little bit like on the gorier side.
A little more gory.
Knives Out. It's so it's like a family ritual and you really don't know what, you don't really know what the stakes are fully for the family.
No, it like takes a while for you to like figure out what's going on. Because I didn't really know what like this movie was about. And so when I watched it, I was like, oh, we're going to play some games.
Fun. I still, because I did, it was on TV the other day and I did watch it. And I still kind of don't know everything. I still don't understand everything. But so she pulls like the hide and seek card. She's like, oh, we're going to play hide and seek around these their old mansion.
I'm sorry,
manor.
If that was me, I'd be like,
I'm okay.
I want to go on my honeymoon with your rich people money.
Right. I'd be like, ah.
Yeah.
So essentially she could just have refused to play.
I guess then he'd be like, I don't know. I would just not marry someone like with that my rich? Luck.
You would.
No, I meant if I was the man in the situation. If I was part of the family, I was like, with my luck, they would definitely get the hide and seek card.
Mm-hmm.
And they would be dead.
Yeah.
And then there goes all my wedding.
Yeah.
And my partner forever. It's just so cool. She like literally just
she literally in her little goes. She literally goes dress. From knowing not knowing anything that's going on, just being like, "I'm so happy I'm married," to like destroying a my whole crazy freaking family.
Yeah,
which I love.
I think the only thing I have about this one is she's so like bronze. Like she's so just like fighting her way. She mm-hmm. doesn't like really try to outsmart them until the end, kind of. So I think that, I mean, if you like that, that's a good portrayal, because usually it's like, oh, the women can't fight she their does, way, so she they have does to outsmart.
Kind of, she does kind of.
Yeah, kind of.
She's like using the cameras and stuff. But she does like, I mean, she...
she really bites. She gets shot in the hand.
Yeah.
Ow.
She gets... There's a lot of gore in this one.
But it's kind of like fun.
Yeah, you're it's like fun gore. The end.
You also like want everyone to die, so you're like...
Yes. Except for, it's kinda except nice. For the brother who like helps her. Adam Brody.
Yeah.
His character.
Yeah.
Yeah, the end is spoiler alert, really gross. He dies anyways.
Right.
The end is gross, but it's kind of amazing.
It's
kind of
funny. Yeah, it's hilarious.
It's amazing.
I love how she just walks out and she's like...
And she's just laughing.
Yeah.
She's like... She just laughs.
So what are you supposed to do?
Because they all kind of got what they deserved. Again, a little bit revenge. I mean, she didn't forced really revenge. Do anything to get the revenge herself besides just say, I want a divorce.
Yeah.
That was a power move.
Power line.
I want a
At
divorce.
At that point, it would probably be an annulment, right?
Yeah.
We won't say anything about that.
Mm-mm. We're not talking. We're not.
I just love that old money, crazy family. Like, we always talk about how we like the old, like the small town.
Mm-hmm. Small town
thing, but I also really love when it's like family. A crazy family, mm-hmm. and you're like, why do y'all just go along with this? Yes. Like, why hasn't anybody stopped this?
Like, what?
Y'all just are like, yeah, mm-hmm. mm-hmm. We had to fight till the death.
Yeah, we got to keep doing this.
Like, and I just love how they're like, no, if we don't do it, like this is gonna happen. And she's like, y'all are so dumb.
Yeah. Like, but it does happen.
Like, I think that is so. Yeah. Like, I love the writers for just doing that. Mm-hmm. It's so slight.
It's a slay for me, too.
For them doing that.
It's a slay for me. And on the guts scale, it's up there.
I say it's a 9 just because like, of the...
There's a lot of blood.
It's visceral. Oh, what's that one part where she's climbing out of the... She's climbing out of this trench or something, mm-hmm. like in the barn with the kids. And like something happens with her hand. I'm like, ugh. Yeah,
gross. There's a lot of like the stuff
in very,
it. So.
And it's not like short things happen. They're like, let me show you this.
Yeah.
Which is fun.
I'd give it.
If that's your vibe.
Like a 9.
Yeah, me
on
too.
On the gore scale.
Me too. You don't see guts.
Or 8. I don't know.
I give it a 9.
Because I feel like there's room. There's always room for more gore, you know? So.
Okay, you crazy.
I'm not saying. Okay.
You nasty.
We're moving on.
She wanted more people to die.
I didn't say that.
Moving on. This will be no surprise to our loyal fan base.
Mm-mm.
We love Pearl.
Pearl.
We love her.
We love
We
Pearl.
Love Mia Goth. We love Pearl. Mm-hmm. We, some of us love X. Some of us are so
some
excited
of us
for Max.
Need to rewatch it.
See me doing the X.
I see it.
Get it?
I get it.
Anyway.
Anyways, so synopsis. In case you didn't know, here's the synopsis of Pearl.
Be special, dancing up on the screen like the pretty girls in the pictures.
Trapped on an isolated farm, Pearl must tend to her ailing father under the watch of her mother. Lusting for the glamorous life she's seen in movies, Pearl's temptations and repressions collide. This came out in 2022. It was directed by Ty West, known for X and The House of the Devil. It was written by Ty West and Mia Goth.
Slay queen.
Slay queen.
I like how they say lusting for the glamorous life, because that's very true.
Yes, it is. There's a lust.
I
there.
Also thought they were going to say Pearl's temptations and repressions crocodile. When I said, I was like,
it could.
It could crocodile.
It could say that.
The alligator.
Mm-hmm.
This is another one with some complicated mother-daughter relationships.
Yes.
And I will go to my grave saying that, and I know some people in this room even don't agree with me, but the part in the dining room scene,
mm-hmm.
is like more powerful to me than the Hereditary dining room scene.
Oh
yeah, I know. I'm getting some head shakes.
Oh, okay. From God.
From God. I just think it is like, the amount of chills I had. I was like, I have never seen and anything like that in my life.
Her whole monologue that she does, her, like, how long? It's like 5 minute monologue of her just like,
this is what pisses me off. This is what pisses me off. I'm going to go on a rant right now.
Let me hear it.
Like, how are you going to tell me that Mia Goth didn't get nominated for an Oscar? How are you going to tell me Pearl didn't get nominated for an Oscar? You know what I mean? Was this within Oscar times for this one?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. God?
God says yes.
Okay.
Because horror movies are just not acknowledged like they should be.
Also,
that's why we have the Screamies.
That's why we have the Screamies. That's why we gave Pearl many an award. Mm-hmm. The shipping racked up on that one.
Yes. It was expensive, y'all. It was
expensive. We couldn't afford a real set because of this is how you need to watch this one too. Okay, I'll tell you. I watched this one, maybe not on my really tiny TV that's smaller than a laptop, but watch it in your room, dark. I had my fairy lights on. I had candles going. Mm-hmm. I was under my little blankie and I was just like, you know, like, I feel like this is a solo experience, like, especially for a young woman who has like felt trapped like that, who wants something big in life. Mm-hmm. You're just going to resonate with this. Someone who loved, like, we've talked about this so much, but
yeah,
someone who loved The Wizard of Oz, mm-hmm. like, you're going to fall
dreaming,
in love.
The dreaming of a bigger life sort of thing.
And feeling trapped. And she literally is trapped. Like, if you really think about it, she had no money, no prospects,
and being
nothing.
Back in that time too. Yeah. Like,
she had a bike.
Yes.
She couldn't even buy candy on her way home.
And she had a scarecrow.
Yes.
Her little
She did have a scarecrow.
She did have.
Her sweet, sweet scarecrow.
Yes.
She just, like, wanted affection. And she wanted all of these things that you crave as a young girl. Because, like, you know that song? I kept thinking, like, this is so, like, Lana Del Rey. So, like, young and beautiful. So, like, what's that Taylor Swift song with Phoebe Bridgers? Taylor Swift fan. Will you still want me when I'm nothing
new? Oh, yeah.
Nothing new. Mm-hmm. Yeah. When you, as a woman, you're kind of told, like, your beauty's going to fade. Like, your beauty's going to fade. And then, like, no one's going to like you.
Or, like, you better find a man who is going to want to stay with you when
you're old. Literally told,
like,
that.
He's also old. What are you talking about?
Yeah, but it's okay if men, like, age. Mm-hmm. But if women age, it's like, ew. Like, why don't you have Botox? Why don't you do something about it? Why aren't you
younger?
Skinny? Yeah, you know, like, it's forever. You're forever battling that. And you're forever told that you're going to age and no one's going to like you, mm-hmm. and blah, blah, blah.
You're going to lose your worth. And I mean, it's just obvious, like, in Hollywood itself, mm-hmm. like, how people overreact to see, like, Jamie Lee Curtis, like, with wrinkles. It's like, she's an older woman. What are you talking about?
Yeah. And there's so many botched surgeries now. And, like, you know, it's sad. Mm-hmm. But it's also, like, somebody who wants to do something with their life and wants to be a star in some capacity. Everybody wants to be a star to somebody.
Yes.
You know?
Even if it's not this big, grand Hollywood scale.
Yeah.
Everyone wants to feel like a priority. Mm-hmm. To someone else or to something else, you know.
Yeah. And a lot of women are, like, pushed on that, like, mm-hmm. manic pixie dream girl-esque, like, you have to be completely desired by mm-hmm. every person in the room. And it's just not something that
is realistic. Not reality.
Yeah.
It's not reality.
And it'll drive you a little crazy.
Yeah.
It'll drive you little hatchet, a little crazy.
Yes.
I think this is just, like, very, very eye-opening. And I think it's such a, if you've ever related to anything I just said, then you just need to watch this. Yes. And
obviously it's turned up, and it's, there's an extreme to it. And there's, like, a level of, clearly something is broken in her.
But she knows that too.
She does know it. And that's also what's incredible about this.
Yeah, she can
admit
it.
Recognizing that something is wrong with me. I'm going to still shove this pitchfork down this guy's throat, mm-hmm. but something is wrong with me, and I acknowledge that. Mm-hmm. And I think snaps for
acknowledging mental illness.
Mental illness.
Good job, Pearl.
Mm-hmm. We love
her
for
it. You. It's such a slay.
Slay for me.
Easily a slay. It's like bloody but no guts.
Yeah. It's in the blood, like we've talked about this before, the blood is very colorful. It's very red. It's
like Technicolor.
Yes. So I don't know. I give it like a solid 5.
Yeah. I think, I mean, our friend watched this with us and she does not do horror. Like
any of that stuff.
So,
and she liked it.
She loved it. Yeah. So if that says anything, watch it, please. Please, everybody watch it.
Yes.
Now we're moving on to Midsommar, which are we surprised with this one?
I'm not.
I thought you were going to say, yeah, I am.
I saw the notes.
Okay. Here's a synopsis for Midsommar.
I was so very sorry to hear about what happened.
I'm sorry.
Several friends travel to Sweden to study a summer festival that is held every 90 years in the remote hometown of one of them. What begins as a dream vacation in a place where the sun never sets gradually turns into a dark nightmare as the mysterious inhabitants invite them to participate in their disturbing festive activities. This came out in 2019, written, directed by Ari Aster, known for Hereditary. Now, I was finally convinced to watch this movie because I refused because of how scarred I am from Hereditary.
Did we watch it together? Did I show it to you?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And
that was like not that long ago either.
No, this is the first time I watched it.
Oh my gosh. Yay.
It was, if you're scared of it because of Hereditary, don't be, because they're different. Yeah. They're not comparable. It's such a different, like, I don't know. It does deal with grief and loss.
Yes. It's very intense. In a different way. It is very intense in that way. And obviously,
pretty disturbing.
Our Florence Pugh, who's the star, she does a really
she has amazing great things. Job. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think it's an interesting perspective on grief I've lost a lot of people close to me, but I was much younger, so I couldn't really understand that weight. And then seeing it from her, like someone my age having to deal with that, like I could not imagine. Mm-hmm. Plus, like dealing with a toxic relationship, you know, and not having any sort of support system, like everybody is gone for her.
Mm-hmm.
And so
this man who really doesn't give a shit.
No, he does not care about her. And it's, you can see how she can like love being accepted by this cult. It's a cult.
Yes, it's called.
It's a cult. Being accepted and welcomed and worshipped in a way. And completely accepted no matter what, who she is, you know? And I think that's a really interesting way to see it, because it's usually like, I don't know, she never was like, this is wrong, like, this is horrible. She was just kind of like, like, just looking.
Right. Observing. There was obviously the part when they
jump off.
When the people jump off the cliff, she obviously had issues with that.
Yeah.
But she moved on from it pretty quickly.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, is that all? That's all you have to do? That's bad.
Yeah. And I think, like, she's able to lose her identity in these people, which is, I think it's just one of those things with grief and losing. I mean, she loses her entire family, and then she loses the man that she thought she loved. And so she turns to these people who are like, let's all breathe together as one and be one and person.
Drink this yummy tea. Yeah. I think it's also really interesting that this cult has a huge, like, central integral part with women, and the women, like, run this thing.
Oh, yeah.
Like, and the men know that too, which is nice, because they're like, oh yeah, like we couldn't do it without them. And like, they're seen as equals, like the women and men in a way. Like, they're like, yes, the men do this part, the women do this part, and we're equal for that.
Mm-hmm.
Which is like, some people can't even get with that nowadays. Right. You know, like,
no, right.
And they're not cults. But I think this would be, we watched it together, like a fun one with your,
it's friend. It's super fun.
It's super it's fun.
Not,
like,
it's not fun. I wouldn't say it's fun. It is a vibe. It's for sure a vibe.
It's really like, it is.
It's pretty.
Trigger warning for grief and sadness. Yes. For sure.
And there's some graphicness to it. And then at the end, you're like kind of left being like,
oh,
did she get. Like, did he, the toxic boyfriend, did he get what he deserved? Was that really what he deserved? Maybe not, but she got what she deserved in a lot of ways.
The way that people are like, oh my gosh, good for her, good for her in this movie, I thought he was going to be way worse.
Yeah.
It's really so whenever like he was like not doing like, I was like, oh.
He just like was not, wasn't a good boyfriend.
No.
Like he just
should not be a boyfriend, period.
He needed to break up with her because he was going to break up with her like the night that her family died. So in some ways, like him staying with her, and he was there for her, just not in the way she needed. I don't know. It was an
unfortunate situation
about it. But
I thought it was gonna be way worse.
Yeah,
but what I heard before.
At the end of it, I think she gets what she deserves, which is a family.
A family.
That's all.
I just feel so
any young girl
you just feel bad
want.
For her the whole movie. You're like, oh my gosh, this poor yeah. girl.
She's just going through it.
Yeah.
So at the end, when she's smiling finally, like a genuine smile on her face, you're like,
yay,
good for her.
Yeah, good for her. She got a little smile. yeah. It's a fun one.
It's super fun.
I have some honorable mentions though.
Oh, okay.
I have Rosemary's Baby,
which I haven't seen.
Yeah, that's why we didn't talk about it, because she hasn't seen it. This is like the fashion, number one. Okay, mm-hmm. I'll say that first of all. Number one, the fashion. It's like New York, 70s, beautiful, 60s, 70s, 60s, that vibe, that era. So beautiful. Mommy. It's a mommy. She's hot. I love it. It's like psychological horror with a hot lady. Anyway, Last Night in Soho. Have you seen that? I didn't like it, but it might be for some people. It would, I think, like it'd be for some people if you really like Anya Taylor-Joy. If you really like her, watch that one.
But the main girl, I could not stand her.
If you really, really can
stand. If you
stand,
can really stand.
Also, Silence of the Lambs, because I feel like Clarice is iconic, but she gets overshadowed.
She does by the villains.
Yeah, because they're also.
But she's
really
the
iconic.
Friggin' one that figured it out, and she went there, and she went in there, without backup, and she defeated him.
Yeah,
and figured it out.
So I think she deserves a little more recognition, and that's why she's in my honorable mentions.
Good.
Do you have any honorable mentions?
I didn't think of any. So,
what about All the Women in the Descent that I haven't seen?
Oh yeah. That would have been my honorable mention if I'd thought of it. Would be The Descent, because there are so many women. It's all women. And the female dynamics, the friendship dynamics, there's grief. It's just like, I don't know. I've already talked about that for hours, and I could talk about it for hours. And I'm going to make you watch it.
Okay. I was looking at pictures of it earlier.
It's just
for a project.
It's just so scary and good. I love it.
Okay.
Okay. I'll watch it. After this.
Okay. Just to wrap it up, let's talk about what's coming next in the horror community.
We're
going to
call this horror news.
Wait, that's the Mario Kart.
Theme song.
When he gets a star. Okay, can you put Mario coming across the screen real quick?
Yeah. To deliver the horror news.
Thank you, Mario.
Thank you, Mario. Yahoo!
Okay, the Mario Woo-hoo! Movie is coming out. That's our
Didn't
horror
news. Didn't
it
already news. Come out?
No.
Oh.
No.
Emily knows.
Okay, horror news. I'm excited because this might be, maybe we should do part two. But there's so many other horror girly movies that we can talk about.
Yeah.
Maybe this will be in our part two, because the It Follows director, David Robert Mitchell, is making a new thrill ride of a film, as stated by him, shot on IMAX, which means nothing to me, but is starring Anne Hathaway.
We love Anne Hathaway. In a horror movie? In a horror movie? I'm living for
know.
It.
I need
living.
It,
slay.
I don't know anything about it at all, but I would like. Dude, I love Anne Hathaway. I was saying that she's
bad
trying
robot?
To do...
It's a Bad Robot movie.
I don't know who Bad Robot is.
It's a production company. J.J. Abrams.
Who's J.J. Abrams? I'm kidding.
Ever heard of him?
Yeah. Wait, what is this? I just like... I opened the article and now I'm like, okay, wait. Other projects currently in development at Warner Brothers, Discovery under the studios deal with Bad Robot, including, okay, this is a Superman film adaptation to Dr. Seuss's iconic children book, Oh, the Places You'll Go. Why are y'all talking about that? Uh-huh. And the Mr. Pinkerton Hot Wheels pick. Why are y'all talking about that?
Are they making All the Places You'll Go a horror movie?
No.
Oh.
They're just making
Maybe it. They should.
Okay. Anyway, I'm going to watch this.
Yeah. Whatever it is, I'll watch it.
I hope it's like, wait, should she do... Oh, wait. She was Elle Enchanted. Elle Enchanted horror? That is pretty horrifying it already. Is.
It was.
If the, I had to obey everything... Having to obey
everything someone says?
No, thank you.
No.
What else is she in? Princess Diaries.
Yes. Horror movie. Princess Diaries horror movie? Maybe. Anyways, moving on. So there's going to be a new Texas Chainsaw Massacre video game that will release in August... I almost said August 2018. August 18th of 2023.
That's this year, folks.
It is with Gun Interactive. Have you ever heard of them? I really liked the Friday the 13th game. I was super into that. And that was, I think, illegally made. And so they've had a bunch of issues with it. So they haven't been able to, like, really continue it or sell it anymore, I don't think. So hopefully this is not illegally made so that stuff doesn't get taken down mm-hmm. for it. But I would be excited to play it if I played video games. But I don't. So I'll watch people play because I do that.
But you have.
No, I've watched people play.
I guess, you know what?
Bleep it.
Bleep it.
We used to
put it over her mouth too. Okay.
You didn't see anything.
Do the like SpongeBob hand wriggle. Yeah.
Do the what is it? The dolphin noise.
From SpongeBob.
Love it.
You know what? I've never seen Alyssa play video games.
I have never played. I've literally sat there and watched.
How come I've always been like, wow, Alyssa just be playing video games?
I
just play
video games because I know about video games because I watch people play video games because I enjoy horror video games.
But not playing them. But you know what? Yeah, that is.
I'd be bad at it.
I was watching the Evil Dead video game, okay? Mm-hmm. And I was like, wow, so fun. Like, woo, scary. Woo. And then I was like, let me try. And then I was like it was so terrifying. It, like, really puts you in it. I was
I did play the Friday the 13th game once, and I just kept running in a circle. It's and so I just kept being like, I just want to hide. I want to hide in the bed. Yes. Like, you can't just hide in the bed because he can heat sense and he can find you. I was like, I'll just hide in the bed. It's fine. He won't know me.
He found you.
Yeah. He found me every
it's
time.
It's like so scary.
Yeah.
I won't play that one. Nobody's going to play it. Nobody here's going to play it.
Nobody here's going to play it, but we will.
But we'll talk about it.
We'll talk about it all day long.
Right now. But I am sad in other news that Bella Ramsey says that The Last of Us might not return until 2025, which actually I'm not that sad about because oh my gosh, you haven't watched it. I'm not sad about because I also heard that it's a big time jump, so give him some time to age, people.
Yeah.
And plus, age 10 years in 2 years.
That doesn't surprise me because I feel like shows do that all the time.
You need to like make it. Like, you need to have time for people to miss it, number one. You need to have time to make it really well, number two. Those are my 2 points.
The end.
That is all.
I don't have any opinions yet because I haven't watched the show. I have
opinions
show.
About the show, but they're not for here.
They're for
my other podcast, my Last of Us podcast. Like
specific Last of Us podcast. Yeah. That only you do.
Where for the next 2 years, I'm going to go over the series frame by frame for an hour. And I'm going to be like, see here where Pedro looks at the camera. This is inspired by the video game. Whenever he looks at the camera in the video game. And he says, this guy.
Anyway. Great idea.
Great idea.
Thank you guys so much for listening and watching, hopefully, our season 2. I almost said finale.
We're done.
Season 2 premiere.
Pack it up, boys.
This was it. It's all we're going to do. Just one we're episode. Done. We are really excited to be back. We're really excited to be trying this format mm-hmm. and hopefully people like it and hopefully we
if you don't keep we don't doing care.
It yeah we won't listen to you
we don't care about your opinions anyway you know where to find us
yeah if you want to follow us you can follow us on Instagram @slashandslaypod or TikTok at /andslaypod. And of course, you can still always email us at /andslaypod@gmail.com to give us your scary stories.
YouTube.
Oh yeah, we're on YouTube.
We're on
now.
YouTube now.
So subscribe.
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 Like.
We have subscribe. To tell people to subscribe. Share. Subscribe to us and we will continue making
subscribe
videos.
To us and we will just keep on trucking. We won't do anything
for
you.
Honestly.
Keep on trucking. But I hope you guys do like this.
Yeah.
Maybe like seeing our faces. Ding. Ding. Can you put a little
ding, ding.
My teeth shining? Ding. Okay, love you guys. Bye.
Love you guys. Bye.